My name is Grace Marie Turner. I'm president of the Galen Institute. The Galen Institute is a nonprofit research organization that specializes in free market ideas for health reform. The Galen Institute is funded by a number of individuals, companies, and philanthropic organizations, companies inside and outside the health sector. But we have a broad base of funding from people who believe in our work to promote free market ideas for health reform. There are so many ways that this health reform legislation is going to harm the economy, and in fact, I think already is. We're already starting to see health insurance costs go up. Some companies have already said that many of the costs are a direct result of the new mandates in the health reform law. We have seen evidence from the Congressional Budget Office that health costs will go up by at least $2,100 a year for individuals purchasing health insurance in the individual market over what they otherwise would have been. So the president has told people that they'll get a $2,500 reduction in their health care costs. The Congressional Budget Office says that actually health costs will go up $2,100 over and above what they otherwise would have been. That's a $4,600 hit to people purchasing health insurance in the individual market. It's going to do nothing to reduce health care costs. It's going to increase the budget. Doug Holtz-Aiken, who's the former director of the Congressional Budget Office, says that the subsidies for individuals to get health insurance are actually going to be $1.4 trillion over 10 years rather than the $450 billion that the current Congressional Budget Office estimated. And that means that the budget itself is also going to be completely busted by this health insurance reform legislation. I think we already see a number of small businesses and medium-sized businesses that are afraid to hire new employees because of the huge costs and burdens that are going to be imposed on them as a result of this legislation. So it's affecting the federal budget deficit, it's affecting taxpayers. Seniors are very concerned about losing their health coverage because there were such huge cuts to physician payments programmed into this legislation. It's affecting small business, and it's going to affect health insurance costs for all of us. None of that is going to be good for the economy. The legislation takes full effect in 2014, but you can see companies inside and outside the health sector already starting to begin to organize themselves around this legislation. There's a wonderful company in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, Assurant Health, that primarily specializes in selling health insurance to individuals and very small groups. It's having to lay off 130 people starting in October simply because of new regulations that are about to be imposed as a result of Obamacare. So the changes to the economy and the negative changes to the economy already are beginning, even though the full force of this legislation doesn't take effect until 2014. There will be some ability to delay implementation of Obamacare, but they won't be able to stop it or repeal it simply because they wouldn't have the votes in Congress to override what would be an inevitable presidential veto to anything that would significantly derail Obamacare between now and 2012. In my commentary today in the Wall Street Journal, I assume that either one or both houses of Congress could be controlled by Republicans, but I really don't think it makes a difference because neither side, the numbers just aren't there for them to have the two-thirds majority they would need to override a presidential veto. So I look at different things that Republicans could do to slow the implementation of Obamacare. It's called putting the brakes on Obamacare, so that we can have time to adjust and really begin a serious process of repealing and replacing what the great majority of Americans still believe is bad legislation. Almost 60% of Americans want this repealed, and 54% in the latest CNN poll think this legislation is going to be bad for the country, and yet 100% of Americans are going to be affected by it. We've got to fix this. This is a bad piece of legislation that must be repealed and replaced. Well, there are a number of options for Republicans. The first one the Republican leader of the House has said that he's going to defund Obamacare, and particularly some of the provisions that people feel are most onerous, like the army of new IRS agents that are going to be needed to enforce it. There also are some efforts to dismantle it, to take it apart, some of the most objectionable parts of Obamacare that even many Democrats believe are bad. The CLASS Act, this new long-term care program, yes, we need long-term care. Even the Democratic chairman of the Senate Budget Committee, Kent Conrad, has called this a Ponzi scheme of the first order. So there's several things they can do to dismantle it. They can delay implementation. The Medicare Advantage cuts that are going to cause millions of seniors to lose health plans that they like in Medicare need to be delayed. $500 billion in new taxes, the individual mandate, the mandate on employers, all of those are coming too fast. The regulatory process can't keep up. They're bad for the economy. They need to be delayed so we can get this right. Finally, Congress can look at disapproving regulations. There are a lot of regulations that are at least as impactful as the legislation itself. They have a tool called the Congressional Review Act that they could use to shine a light on particularly egregious regulations. As far as oversight and investigation, they can look at really shine a light on some of the impacts of this legislation. How many jobs are being lost? What's happening to health costs? How many seniors are finding it difficult to access coverage? Holding hearings, investigating and looking at the costs of this legislation to protect taxpayers. And then finally, to delegate more authority to the states, to give them the authority and the responsibility to begin to make the kinds of changes that they know work for their states, their economies, and their budgets. The Healthy Indiana program, the Utah Health Exchange are a couple of examples that I cite in my commentary in the journal as ways that the states could begin to take more authority and control with federal resources and federal encouragement and incentives.